Hello, I'm Denise Galooney. Welcome to today's episode of Empowering You. My guest today is Hanifa Nachidowa. Hanifa is from Uganda, and she's an amazing woman with an inspirational story that's going to melt your heart and inspire you. I hope you enjoy today's episode. My guest today is Hanifa Nachidowa. She's originally from Uganda and is an active member in the Pittsburgh community. She is very passionate and an advocate for women's and children's rights and represents women's voices on different platforms, both locally and internationally. She's a TEDx speaker and uses her experience surviving a brutal acid attack in Uganda to raise awareness and empower women who have experienced intimate partner violence and abuse. She understands firsthand what dealing with sudden life-changing events feels like and offers useful tips on how to thrive through and rise above such events. Hello, Hanifa.
Hi, Denise. It's so nice to be here with
you. Oh, I'm so happy you're here. I tried for a long time to get you on Empowering Women. It just never worked out for us.
Isn't that the benefit of the pandemic right now?
Everything virtual, right? Things are a lot easier. And that's funny because you mentioned the pandemic, which is going on right now while we're recording this. Mm-hmm. That is causing a lot of adversity.
Oh, yeah.
And that's one of the things that you speak about is adversity.
Yes, I do.
Yes. Can you tell us a little bit about your story, as much as you feel comfortable with sharing with the audience about your story?
Sure. I come from Uganda, as you earlier mentioned, and that's where I survived the brutal acid attack. It's a form of violence commonly used in my country. Like gun violence is common here because of easy access to guns. In my country, there is easy access to concentrated acidic chemicals that can cause bodily harm that leads to disfigurement for the rest of your lives.
Oh my gosh.
So I was trying to get out of a violent and abusive marriage and to try to, you know, redeem my life. And it's common that when you're married, it's for better, for worse. But yes. In my case, I felt it was always for worse, and I needed to change the narrative.
Right.
Especially after becoming a mother to two wonderful daughters.
Right. It wasn't about you anymore. It was about your family, your daughters.
Right, Denise. It wasn't about me anymore. I started looking at my daughters and imagined the kind of women they would be in their mm-hmm. generation.
Right.
What kind of role model am I as a mother, as a wife, as a community member? So it's because of my daughters that I committed to myself to break the silence,
mm-hmm.
to break the dynamics around marriages in my culture, in my religion, and choose who I really wanted to be as a mother raising two wonderful daughters who will be women someday and become mothers and as a wife who is stepping up as a role model to my daughters who will someday be wives.
Right.
So that's when I decided I needed to choose my next move. And I decided I couldn't keep up with that kind of toxic marriage because then I didn't want to pass it on to my children. Children are usually the invisible victim of intimate partner violence and abuse. The children are always the invisible victims. They witness, they can't process, but they internalize, and it manifests in their later stages in life.
Mm-hmm.
My children witnessed the abuse, you know, the way I was treated as their mother mm-hmm. and the kind of lifestyle in the household. And I felt every day so broken because I knew it was not a healthy environment for my children.
Right.
But at the same time, I had an attachment and a degree of dependence in that marriage that I could not simply walk out.
Hanifa, in Uganda, is it forbidden to get divorced or is it just discouraged?
It's extremely discouraged.
Okay. So it's completely different.
It is condemned on women who try to divorce and live independent lives. You are named and shamed and labeled in the community. You are treated like an outcast.
Okay.
So that's why women endure abuse and violence. That's why women endure all forms of oppression, especially once we have children, then you have to give up your life. Mm-hmm. And live and sacrifice yourself for your children.
Right.
Little do they know that actually you're passing on that trauma to your children generation after generation.
Right.
Yeah, I felt that conviction and I felt I didn't want my children to experience what I was experiencing. So I decided to quit. And when I quit, that's when my ex-husband, a few months later, after several negotiations that usually go on each time a woman tries to get out of a marriage, and you know, they gather elders and family members to try to talk a woman into going back to her marital home. I tried to quit up to three times and they would take me back. And each time they gathered community elders and family elders, I would always tell them, this is not healthy for me and the long-term consequences may not be the best. But to have a voice as a woman in my culture is not acceptable.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We are treated as subordinate, as relative. Our voices are our concerns are voiced through the males in our lives. If it's not my father, it's my uncle. If it's not my uncle, it's my brother. The males have the upper say in every decision for the women.
Right.
And I was trying to have a say in my own personal experience, and I didn't get the audience. But then I strategize that the next time I quit, I'm not going back to family. I am stepping up and standing on my foot and starting a new life.
That's amazing, Hanifa. What courage and strength you've had.
Well, I can't take pride in that courage, but I think experience builds character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't have children, but I would assume as a mother, that's your main priority is your daughters, getting them out of that situation.
It was. My main priority was my daughters. Secondly, I was working in one of the UN agencies. I had just got the contract working as a program monitoring and evaluation specialist for a UNICEF program. And I was a spokesperson for eliminating all forms of violence and abuse against women and girls.
Yeah.
And each time I was on camera or being interviewed for print media, then I would step back and reflect on my own situation.
Mm-hmm.
And indeed, many women in power, many women in leadership positions in my country, they live such double standards lives.
Right.
They live such double standard lives. They reach out in the public and they are preaching something different from what they are experiencing in their own homes.
Mm-hmm.
But we mask it off and try to paint the beautiful, wonderful, perfect picture of a perfect marriage.
We have a saying in America, you don't know what goes on behind closed doors.
Exactly the same in my country. And that's the reason abuse and oppression in intimate partner violence still persists
mm-hmm.
in my country.
Yeah.
So that's the step I had to take.
Right.
For me, for my daughters, for my sisters, and for the women in the communities that I served.
Yeah, absolutely. So is that when you decided to leave then and come to America?
When I decided to leave, and 3 months later, I was invited by my ex-husband in a spot where somebody was waiting for me there with a jar of concentrated sulfuric acid. And the next I knew, I was in the ICU unit in our referral hospital battling acid attack burns. I lost my right eye. I lost my nose. I literally lost my entire identity, Denise.
Absolutely.
But one thing I did not lose was the will to fight. Mm-hmm. And because I knew where I wanted my life to be. I knew what I was fighting for. I knew why that was happening to me. And somehow God prepared me for it.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, the courage is just unbelievable. I can't even express how much courage you had. I think it's hard to imagine. In this country, it's hard to imagine something like that. And you equate it to gun violence, which is so prevalent here in America. Because yes. we've heard about acid attacks, but we don't really think about it that much. We think it's an isolated thing, but you're saying it's not. It's very prevalent in Uganda.
And it's important that you point out that you've heard about acid attack violence, but you don't think it's prevalent.
Right.
That was my same experience. I did not know about acid attacks until I was in the hospital with over 30 acid attack patients in December of 2011. Mm-hmm. It's always the worst month. I don't know why. I don't know what's wrong with December that the hospital prepares for acid attack patients.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, and then I was brought to the awareness of a problem I didn't know, and I felt it was my duty to raise that awareness. Mm-hmm. Secondly, people will tell your narrative if you stay silent, and I experienced that firsthand. Mm-hmm. People started creating a narrative of my experience, and I felt the need to actually own my story,
right.
Own my script, and use it to raise awareness, and use it to actually break the silence, and use it to actually be a platform for women. I carry visible scars, Denise, but we know not all intimate partner violence leaves you with visible scars where someone will ask you, oh, Hanifa, what really happened to you? Tell me about it. Women are dying inside. They are wounded. They are scarred.
Hanifa, is this what warranted you to do a TED Talk? That you wanted to do a TEDx talk about this? Is that what the adversity and surviving that? Was that the basis of your TEDx talk?
Oh, yes. You know, the best of my TEDx talk was trying to redefining what identity is. What do we define as identity, you know? Because in my case, I reflect on my recovery journey, and I have been through a series of identities. Each time I walk into an operating room, I come out looking differently. A few months down the road, you'll find me looking differently. How I looked a year ago is different from how I look today. The good news is I look better every day. But then this gave me a, you know, deep thought of who I really am and it gave me a deep thought and reflection on who I really am and how I identify myself.
Right.
I went through one person within a blink of an eye. I wasn't prepared for this. Mm-hmm. I find myself the next day without a face. You're dreaming the previous day. You find yourself the next day with all your dreams put on a pause or shattered.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to rebuild your life from scratch from torn pieces and you have to put them together to create a whole. So to me, that was a redefinition of my new identity that people would know me by, you know, mm-hmm. Hanifa, the woman who is courageous, the woman right. who is resilient, the woman who has overcome this, the woman who demonstrates that nothing is impossible when you put your thought to it.
Absolutely. And that's how I know you. This courageous, amazing woman who's a lot of fun. We had a lot of fun the last time we were together. We laughed a lot.
And that's a woman beyond my facial scars.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think the people that are closest to you, we don't even see those scars. We just see you.
I hear that a lot of, you know, many times I hear that, you know, each time people, you know, just like you, you're like, oh, you actually, you know what? Looking at you so closely, I don't see your scars anymore.
just you. Yeah.
And that's the identity that I'm talking about.
Absolutely.
But the society has conditioned us to think about identity and beauty in a different way. And if we are in the 21st century, it's different. We are embracing diversity.
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah, and this is one way to embrace diversity. I feel beautiful, and every woman, every individual, every human being should feel beautiful in their own skin, regardless.
Right. Hanifa, do you want to talk about your nonprofit?
So my nonprofit, the Center for Rehabilitation of Survivors of Acid Attack Violence, CERESAV, is a Uganda-based nonprofit that I founded as a out of this inspiration. How do I actually bring this awareness to women that beyond the scars, you are still a woman?
Right.
Carry yourself as a woman. Build your confidence with your scars. Wear your scars with pride and let people see the woman in the scars, full and complete. That was my inspiration to start that nonprofit. And our focus is to save lives in the hospital, because that's where most people give up on life and mm-hmm. give up to the fight, and many die. Others are driven into chronic PTSD. They never rise up again. So our focus is to get them in the hospital, take care of their medical bills, take care of all their medical needs and nutrition needs and psychosocial needs, to make sure that they rise out of that stage mm-hmm. and reintegrate back into the community. Then in the community, we try to connect them to others in the community. There have been new organizations coming up that are providing that kind of community-based support. We had an inaugural survivor support group that has branched out and created a separate survivor support organization, where many of the survivors now have transitioned and they are helping with that. So CERESAV focuses on supporting patients to survive in the hospital. And right. then recently I started an education fund. It's a struggle to deal with the acid burns. You go through reconstructive surgeries and you have medical needs for the rest of your life. And they are really expensive. We don't have a healthcare system in my country that can take care of that. I mean, we're still struggling with that in America. Yeah. So we decided, as the mothers and these acid attack families are struggling for survival, let's relieve them in terms of educating their children so that they don't have a lot on their plate. So I recently launched a CERESAV education fund for children of survivors of acid attack violence in Uganda.
That's wonderful. And Eva, when this happened to you, this horrific acid attack, was there a support group? Could you have people to lean on?
No, there was no such a support group. What I mean by that is you really want to resonate with the person talking to you, giving you that support, right? Mm-hmm. You want to know that when I say, oh, Denise, I really hear you. I can really understand. It really makes sense to you and it sinks in.
Right.
There wasn't such a support group at my time.
Okay. Yeah, I can't imagine just going through that without someone to talk to and someone to help you through that.
It was difficult. I won't say it was smooth. I had my days, and it was the awakening for me to actually do this.
Yeah. And when did that happen, Hanifa?
It happened in December 2011.
2011. And then when did you come to Pittsburgh?
I settled in Pittsburgh in January of 2016.
And what made you pick Pittsburgh?
That's an interesting question that I get a lot of time. Through my work, I supported women, and one of them died, and then I tried to help her children, four of them, but at that time I hadn't even registered the nonprofit. I had registered the nonprofit, but it hadn't kicked off.
Right.
So I reached out, and made a public appeal, which I usually do. I do it all the time. You see it on my Facebook page. Huh? I made a public appeal for a good Samaritan to help these four children.
Absolutely.
Have a place to call home, have a chance to have an education.
Mm-hmm.
And an orphanage in Uganda took them in on the Christmas Eve of 2012. I still feel that's the best Christmas.
Oh my gosh.
The children could ever have. That orphanage is supported by a PhD professor who read the article where I was making the public appeal.
Right.
I got to meet him in 2014. And his question was, have you ever considered going back to school? You sound pretty fairly learned. And I was like, why not? If I get a scholarship, definitely yes. He said, okay, put in your application. And I did. I have a master's degree in economics, but this redefinition of who I am, mm-hmm. then got me thinking of where I see my life moving forward in terms of career growth, mm-hmm. where do I want to see myself? And I really did not see myself in the economics field.
Mm-hmm.
I saw myself more in the humanitarian field.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a calling.
Yeah, so I decided it's time to jump into a new field. So I chose to come to Pitt to study a second master's degree in international development with a special interest in human security studies.
Yeah. And that's why I said you're an amazing woman, Hanifa. What can we do to help you and your nonprofit?
Well, I always ask people, I cannot save the world, but I can save one woman. I can save one family at a time.
Right.
And the ripple effect goes on. So all I'm looking for is for champions who can sponsor a family, champions who can sponsor a child, champions who can support this education fund, because I know the power of education got me where I am.
Mm-hmm.
I have experienced firsthand with my women what it means not to have an education. I see the struggles they go through. I see how they struggle to thrive.
Mm-hmm.
I see how long it takes them to paint a bigger picture beyond their current circumstances. And this is what I'm talking about with this current pandemic.
Right.
I am not looking at the current condition. Yes, this is a moment. We are in this moment, mm-hmm. but what is ahead of it? And that's where I focus all my energy. And that's a tip I give people. Look beyond being in the hospital. Look beyond dealing with the wounds. They are going to heal. You're going to have the scars. Then what? Think about that life. Look beyond where you are and envision who you could become. What is the possibility?
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I focus my attention. That's where I focus my energy. That's what I encourage women dealing with abuse, dealing with trauma, not to focus on the situation.
Right.
Paint a picture of what could be beyond the situation.
And that's an amazing way to end this interview. Hanifa, thank you so much for sharing your story and just, it's just amazing. And I'm so honored that you're my friend. And I wish you all the best.
You are welcome, Denise, anytime. And people, they are free to reach out if they need me to come and speak to their groups. My Facebook page is open. I'm very responsive. I love interacting with people. I love being around people. If there is anything I can bring to the room, I love bringing that energy to the room.
And we're going to have your contact information on during this interview, so they'll be able to reach out to you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Denise.
Thank you, Hanifa.
You're welcome. Have a wonderful weekend.
You too. Thank you for watching today's episode of Empowering You. I'd like to thank my guest, Hanifa Nachidawa, for sharing her story and inspiring people around her. Hanifa is a perfect example of why I'm doing this show, to help empower you to overcome adversity, motivate you, and inspire you to live the best life you can live. Thank you for watching today's episode, and see you next time.